Our dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you right now for blessing us to be able to come to your word. Lord, we humbly come to your throne, seeking to surrender all to you, to surrender to you ourselves and our minds as we're going to enter into a deeper study and consideration of your holy word. We ask for your Holy Spirit to convict us of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment, and that your Holy Spirit may so work in our hearts, causing us to walk according to your statutes and your judgments. God, we want to completely give up ourselves, forsake our ways, and walk in the only way, which is your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for all the promises that you've accomplished for us in him. Lord, as we study these matters, that they may be a living reality in our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Welcome back, brothers and sisters, to our series on Christ as our covenant. We want to turn our Bibles right now to Matthew chapter 24. Let's go to Matthew chapter 24 because it is very important that we understand that the study of the covenants is what the entire Bible is based upon. We serve a God of promises. And in the book of Matthew in chapter 24 and verse 14, a well-known text, the Bible says something very important regarding the gospel. The Bible there in verse 14 of Matthew, the 24th chapter, it says, "And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come." Brothers and sisters, we've made it so clear in our previous studies that we're living in the time of the end. These are the final moments of this earth's history. Jesus is getting ready to come back, and there is a gospel that will hasten his second coming. There is a work that will hasten the second coming of Jesus Christ, and you need to be sure, my brother and my sister, that you're a part of that work and that you're experiencing the gospel, the promise of God for you. Now, we know that this text is referring to the book of Revelation. We saw this already, Revelation chapter 14. And there we find the three angels' message. Three angels, one message. And then after that, Jesus Christ comes back. That's the end of the world, my brothers and sisters. Okay? And that gospel coming from these three angels is called the everlasting gospel. And the everlasting gospel is God's power, is God's ability to, with the free will of his creature, reproduce in them his character and his righteousness so that they would genuinely behave just like himself. Now, folks, we need that righteousness. We need that character to be reproduced in us. And God has made a promise so that we living in this time would have that covenant promise reproduced in our life and in our hearts. Have you been experiencing the new covenant? Have you been experiencing the new covenant in your life, in your daily walk, with your family? Have you been allowing the Holy Spirit to guide the words that you speak to your wife or to your children or to your brother, to your sister, to your coworker, to your deacon, deaconess at church, to your pastor, whoever? Have you been allowing the new covenant to be your experience, my brother and my sister? Because again, this is the final experience for God's people. We saw how Adam sinned, leaving humanity in a position where he lost that good character that he had, where he lost dominion over the earth and the beasts of the field, where he lost everlasting life. But in the new covenant, God promises to restore all of those things back. God promises to restore righteousness, eternal life, and the eternal inheritance, meaning the eternal new world of his Son, Jesus Christ. All of God's promises we studied are in Christ. All of God's promises are in him, yea, and in him, amen, unto the glory of God by us. All of God's promises are in Jesus Christ, and they are for you. They are for mankind, but for you specifically. You see, Jesus is a personal Savior. So the Bible shows us that in the new covenant, as we studied before, that God wants to restore mankind with the righteousness of his Son, the eternal life of his Son, and the eternal inheritance, new world, of his Son. We know that in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 30, we find that Christ is our righteousness. So that's the righteousness of God for us. That's that promise for us in Christ. As far as for eternal life, in 1 John in chapter 5 and verse 11 and verse 12, let's turn there. We find that this promise of eternal life is found in Jesus Christ again. We're in 1 John chapter 1. I want to just point out the promise of God, because in today's study, we're going to be studying the old covenant. But just a brief little recap of the new covenant before we go into the old covenant. 1 John chapter 5, verse 11 and verse 12, the Bible says, and this is the record that God has given unto us eternal life. And where is it? And this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. So you see, we see that the righteousness of God that he promised to you and to me is found where? In his Son. The eternal life of God that he promised to you and to me in the new covenant is found where? In his Son, Jesus Christ. We just read that here. And he also promised the eternal new world, the eternal inheritance, because man lost dominion over the world and over the beast. And God promises us in the book of 2 Peter in chapter 3 and verse 13, we find the promise which is in Christ. We're in 2 Peter. Chapter 3, and there the Bible says, nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for a new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. So the new heaven and the new earth dwell in righteousness. Therein dwells righteousness. And we know that Christ is righteousness. You understand? Christ is righteousness, and this new earth is going to come out of Christ. That promise is in Christ. So all of God's promises are in Christ. We see now the Bible text that confirm that God's promise in the new covenant of righteousness, eternal life, and the new world are all found in Christ. Only he can fulfill that for mankind. That is the agreement that the Father and the Son came together with in the Council of Peace. That's the agreement that was promised upon. That's the promise that was agreed upon, rather, between the Father and the Son for you. Okay? Now, how are you involved in this is the question. How do we as individuals enter into that agreement? Because again, the agreement is between the Father and the Son, okay? It's not between God and us. It is between the Father and the Son for us, all right? So how do we as individuals enter into that covenant experience? Well, we saw how Abraham entered into that experience. And how did Abraham enter into that experience? Well, the Bible let us know in Genesis chapter 15 and verse 6, that Abraham entered into that experience by faith. So you see, the new covenant experience is the experience of righteousness by faith. And Abraham believed on the Lord, and it was counted unto him for righteousness. That's how Abraham entered into that experience, into that new covenant experience of the promise of righteousness for himself. And so that is how we enter into that experience as well. You see, God does not make contracts with mankind. He doesn't make contracts with us because he knows that we are incapable of keeping our promise to him. Our promises are as ropes of sand. In Steps of Christ, in the French version, it actually says that our promises are as cobwebs, des étoiles d'araignée, cobwebs. They aren't strong. They're feeble, fickle. They wear out. They mess up. They're moldy. They get old. They are filled with fault. They can't work our promises. Only God's promise work. And God's promise is in Christ. So right now, we're living in a time where we need the promise of Christ to work in us in these last days, brothers and sisters. That is why we continue to uplift Christ, because it is in him that we experience salvation, redemption, and righteousness, and eternal life. Now, how do we enter, how do we know that we can enter into that covenant by faith, right? And not by a contract, by us making a contract with God? We know this, that we can enter into that covenant by faith, because, again, God doesn't make contracts with men. God can't make a contract with us because we are not his equal. But we find that God did what? He became us so that his covenant can affect us. Do you see that? You see that God became you so that the covenant promise can spill over to you, can affect your life? That's the only reason why we're alive right now, because there was a promise made that the Creator, Colossians chapter 1 and verse 14 and verse 15 and 16, the Creator would be the Redeemer, okay? So that was a brief recap of the new covenant, and it was important that we went through this as we go into the old covenant to see how much the old covenant does not work. And by the way, the old covenant is not only in the Old Testament. You see, many people in the Old Testament had a new covenant experience. Abel, Seth, Enoch, Sarah, Samson, Moses. You can find them in Hebrews chapter 11, but they're not limited to that list. These folks had a new covenant experience, and we find with some people in the Bible that we see that they have an old covenant experience, they stumble into an old covenant experience, and then move forward in the new covenant experience. And so today we want to study the old covenant. We'll study the process of that in the life of Abraham, how Abraham was working in the new, and then the old, and then the new, and then the old. We see those two covenants working in his life. And we're going to study that in our next study, where we study the obedience of faith. But right now we want to focus on the old covenant, who it came from, how it came into existence, and we're going to see that it doesn't work. We'll also see what is the end time form of the old covenant. What is the end time form of the old covenant? Kneel with me if you can, so that we can begin with a word of prayer as we're going to dive deeper into the word of God. Father in heaven, again, we want to thank you for blessing us with this moment to study your holy word. Right now, Lord, we're going to consider the old covenant. We ask that you may enlighten our minds and our understanding as we're going to look at some seemingly confusing texts in your word. So we ask you to harmonize it. We ask your Holy Spirit to do that work in our hearts and in our minds. We ask all these things in the precious and most holy name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. So we're going to take a look at, brothers and sisters, the old covenant. Now, let's begin with a question. Always good to start from there to get our minds moving. We're going to be thinking in this study. How many covenants did God make with mankind? How many covenants did God make with mankind? One. Only one. God only made one covenant with mankind. The Bible calls it by different names. We know them now, right? The New Covenant, or the Second Covenant, the Everlasting Covenant, the Better Covenant, right? The New Testament. Only one. You see, God's purposes don't change. They don't change at all. Neither does he. They're perfect in all their ways, and they don't need to be revamped or renewed. They may be repeated, but not renewed. And we're going to see that it's not God's covenant that needs to be renewed. It's the hearts of his people that need to be renewed. The Bible says in Psalm chapter 89 and verse 34, "My covenant will I not break, nor alter the thing that is gone out of my lips." This text is saying that Jesus Christ is the covenant and that he will never change. Neither will the covenant. Again, "My covenant will I not break." That covenant is unbreakable. That promise that God made cannot change. It will not break, nor alter, nor change the thing that has gone out of my lips. When you speak and something comes out of your lips, what are those things? words. Jesus is the Word of God, and he will not be altered. It is in Jesus that we have salvation. Jesus, Yeshua, right? It means Jehovah is salvation. So Jesus is God's way of salvation, the only way of salvation, and he will not change. He's the only way that works. You get that? He's the only way that works. And so that's why God is saying that his covenant will not break, because the promise is in Christ. There's no other promise that could work. The Bible says in Acts chapter 4 and verse 12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And we know whose name that is. That is the name of Jesus. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 11, the Bible says, for other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. So Christ is the covenant, the only one covenant, and there's no other covenant. There's no other way of salvation save Jesus Christ. So Christ is the only one covenant of God. He is God's covenant of promise of salvation, righteousness, eternal life, and the new world. Christ. We just saw that it's all in him. So now what is the old covenant? Let's go to Hebrews chapter 8. We went there when we were studying the new covenant, and we specified verse 10. And we're going to look at verse 10, but let's start from verse 8, because from there we're going to see two covenants presented. We're in Hebrews chapter 8, Hebrews the 8th chapter, and we're going to begin from verse 6, actually. Not verse 8, but we're going to begin from verse 6. Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 6. The Bible says, but now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. For finding fault with them, he saith, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them out of the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt, because they continued not in my covenant, and I regarded them not, saith the Lord. Verse 10. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their minds and write them in their hearts. And I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. Now, we just saw a lot of things over here, and we're going to break it down, brothers and sisters. So what I want you to do is take out a piece of paper and a pen or a pencil, preferably a pencil, I guess, because I had the eraser, you could erase if you wrote something wrong. Take out a pencil and a paper, and I want you to write this down on the left side of the piece of paper, right? Put it, you know, put like a line down, right? On the left side, write first covenant. And on the right side, write second covenant. We want to get an idea of the two. What are the qualities of those two covenants? What are said of those two covenants in Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 6 through verse 10? We want to break it down. Now, the first covenant, according to verse 7, the first covenant was a faulty covenant. The first covenant was a faulty covenant, because it says, for if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second. So the first covenant is faulty. It's a faulty one. So under first covenant, write faulty. Under first covenant, write faulty. Under second covenant, write better. Because according to verse 6, the Bible says, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon what? Better promises. Okay? So the second covenant is a better covenant. The first covenant is a faulty covenant. Write it down, because look, it's going to become so clear to you. You're going to say, this is so simple. First covenant is faulty. Second covenant is better, right? Now, why was the first covenant faulty? Why was the first covenant faulty? Well, in verse 8, it says, for finding fault with them. Finding fault with who? Finding fault with them. He saith, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel. So finding fault with them. So what I want you to do is write down that the first covenant under, so what I want you to do under faulty, write no good promises. No good promises. Because the second covenant, according to verse 6, right, is based upon, or the better covenant, which is the second covenant, is based upon better promises, right? It's based upon better promises. So under the second covenant, you wrote better, and under better, you have to write better covenant. Now, under the first covenant, you wrote faulty, and so what is faulty? No good promises. So do you see how everything is lining up so far? The first covenant is faulty and based upon no good promises. The second covenant is better and based upon better promises. Now, for the first covenant, why were they based upon no good promises? Whose promises were those? Who made those promises? Well, we just read in verse 8 that it is the promises of them. For finding fault with them. And who are they? Who are they? They are the children of Israel. Because it goes on by saying that the Lord, it goes on by saying, well, I'll read from start from the beginning of verse 8. For finding fault with them, he saith, behold, the days cometh that the Lord, when I will make a new covenant. When I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Okay? So the promises of them are the no good promises. So under no good promises, right? Promises of them. Okay? And under better promises, under the second covenant, under that tab of the second covenant, right, the promises of God, because God's promise is the better promise of the better covenant, which is the second covenant. Now, this is where things are going to seem to get a little bit tricky, but if we pay very careful attention to this line of truth, then we will not be lost. We just got to keep on following Jesus Christ. Watch this. We just saw that The fault of the first covenant was with them, them being the children of Israel. They are the children of Israel because God goes on to say in verse 9, it says in verse 8 with the house of Israel, but in verse 9 it says, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the days when I took them by the hand to lead them out of Egypt. So this brings us back to the story of when the children of Israel were being led out of Egypt. So in other words, this is leading us back to Exodus chapter 19. Now, you can begin to turn your Bibles to Exodus chapter 19, but make sure you pay close attention to what I'm saying right now. We just read that the first covenant is the faulty covenant, which is based upon faulty promises, no good promises, and it's the promises of them, of the children of Israel. But here in verse 9, God is saying that it is the covenant that he made with their fathers. God is basically taking responsibility for, God is saying that it was his covenant. But we already saw that God only has one covenant. So why is God right now saying that this faulty, no good promises covenant is his? Why is he saying that it's the covenant that he made with the fathers? That's what we want to understand very clearly, because this is where people tend to get really confused. At least this is where I got confused. I mean, I'm looking at this thing and I'm like, wait a minute. This is a faulty promise that doesn't even work. This covenant doesn't work. And God is saying, is the covenant that he made? God made something that doesn't work? Let's study the word of God. What does the Bible say? It says that the promise of them is the old covenant and that the promise of God is the new covenant. In verse 10, he says, this is the new covenant. This is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. In verse, I want to go to that specific verse where he calls it the new covenant. It is in verse 8 where he says, the Lord, when I will make a new covenant. Okay, so let's go back to the graph. I just want to make sure you have it properly. First covenant, faulty, no good promises, promise of them, and also just put in quotes, the covenant that I made with their fathers. That's what God said in verse 9. We want to understand that. And under that, old covenant. That is the old covenant. And under the new covenant, under the second covenant, right, better, and under better, right, better promises, and under better promises, promise of God, and under the promise of God, right, new covenant. Okay, new covenant. So let's go to Exodus chapter 19, because that is where we find the covenant is made, the covenant that God calls, the covenant that he established with the fathers, and the covenant that is called faulty, the promises of them. Let's see what is going on in Exodus chapter 19. We're going to read from verse 1, and we're going to land in verse 9. We want to look at that entire story. We're in Exodus chapter 19, verse 1 through verse 9, and the Bible says, in the third month, when the children of Israel were gone forth out of the land of Egypt, the same day came they into the wilderness of Sinai. Very important. Verse 2, for they were departed from Rephidim and were come to the desert of Sinai and had pitched in the wilderness, and there Israel camped before the mount. And Moses went up unto God, and the Lord called unto him out of the mountain, saying, thus shalt thou say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, ye have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, and how I bare you on eagle's wings, and brought you out, and brought you unto myself. Now therefore, if ye will obey, underline that, my voice indeed, and keep, underline that, my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. Verse 6, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. Verse 7, and Moses came and called for the elders of the people, and laid before their faces all these words which the Lord commanded him. And all the people answered together and said, all that the Lord hath spoken, we will do. And Moses returned the words of the people unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Moses, lo, I come unto thee in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak. And hear when I speak with thee, and believe thee forever. And Moses told the words of the people unto the Lord. Now I want us to zero in on verse 5. Because in verse 5, God is teaching to the now free children of Israel. They were in slavery, but now they're free. God is teaching them from verse 5, righteousness by faith. God is teaching them the first steps. He's slowly teaching them the first steps of righteousness by faith. He begins by saying, now therefore, if ye will do what? Obey. I had you underline that word, obey, for a reason in particular. Because that word obey, the Hebrew word for that word obey is shama. Is the word shama. Now that word means to hear, to listen, to pay close attention. As though you're putting your head down to listen very carefully and attentively. He's saying, hear my voice. Now what happens when you hear the word of God? Romans chapter 10 and verse 17. I know you know this text, but as Peter says in 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 12, wherefore I will not be negligent to keep you always in remembrance of these things, to put you always in remembrance of these things, though ye know them, being established in the present truth. We're still going to turn to Romans chapter 10 and verse 17 to specifically read exactly what it says. What happens when you hear the word of God? Romans chapter 10, because he told them obey. But this word obey is the word shama. And he says, shama, hear, pay close attention to my voice. What happens when we listen to the voice or the word of God? Romans chapter 10 and verse 17. I know you know the text, but we're going to turn there anyway. And the Bible says, so then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So God is teaching them what? Righteousness by faith. So the first thing God is telling them in verse 5, the first thing that God tells them is to obey, hear. Because if they hear what he has to say, then what's going to grow? Faith. Faith is going to grow in their hearts. So he says, obey, hear, because he knows that if they do that, then faith is going to grow. So God is trying to build faith in their hearts. And then he says, keep. And then he says, keep. But before we go, there's a text that comes to mind. Isaiah chapter 53, about hearing the word of God. Isaiah chapter 53, the importance of obey, meaning hear, shema, hear the word of God. Isaiah chapter 53, no, not 53. Isaiah 55, Isaiah 55, yes, Isaiah 55 and verse 3, yes. Incline your ear and come unto me, hear, and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David. So here God was trying to bring into their hearts the secret of his power, of the way to receive his power and eternal life, and experience the everlasting covenant by faith. It's by hearing his word, inclining their ears to hear his word. So he begins by saying, obey my voice. And then he goes on to say, to keep my covenant. So God is already telling them that there's already a covenant. There's already a covenant. There's already a promise. And he wants them to keep it. The only way they can keep it is if they first hear by faith. And then after that, he says, keep my covenant. So his covenant is the everlasting covenant that has always been there. But now he tells them to do what? He tells them to keep it. And that word keep in Hebrew is shamar, which means to hold fast, to cherish, to guard, to treasure. And that word appears in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 14. That same definition for keep appears in 1 Timothy chapter 14, and we have it here. Chapter 1 and verse 14, and the Bible says, that good thing which was committed unto thee. Keep, the Greek word is philasso, which means to cherish, guard, or to take hold of, to treasure. Philasso, keep by the Holy Ghost. How do you keep it? By the Holy, you can't keep it by yourself. You keep it by the Holy Ghost, which does what? Dwells in us. So God is teaching them the new covenant of righteousness by faith. Keep it, how? By my spirit. Ezekiel chapter 36. Ezekiel chapter 36 says the same exact thing, because we keep it by the spirit. So God didn't give them all that explanation, right? He didn't give them all the explanation of, if you hear my word, you're going to grow in faith. If you keep it, then it's going to be kept by my spirit working in your heart. He didn't explain all that. Well, at least I don't see it right there. But that's what the principle is, because as we continue reading the Bible, we see unfolding that truth. They weren't ready to understand all those deep details. So God just wants to give them the simple truth so that they can experience it. Ezekiel chapter 36. Because there are some things about God that we just cannot understand. So he just simply tells us the truth that is for our good. And then at that, when we experience it, we say, God, I understand what you're talking about. So we're in Ezekiel 36. And verse 26, because we just read how we keep the word of God, right? He says, keep my covenant. We keep the covenant, which is his everlasting covenant, by faith, and we keep it by the Spirit. Notice what it says in Ezekiel chapter 36 and verse 26. The Bible says, a new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. You see, they had a spirit of a slave. So God wanted to give them a new spirit within them. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. In verse 27, I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk. Do what? Cause you to walk. We walk by faith, not by sight. To cause you to walk in my statutes, and ye shall keep my judgments and do them. So God again was teaching them in verse 5, righteousness by faith, showing them that it was if they listen, if they hold, keep his promise, his covenant, by this, then the Spirit is going to do that work in their heart, and they will walk according to his statutes, according to his law. And we know that the law of God is righteousness. Psalm chapter 119 and verse 172, that God's law is righteousness. So God was teaching them righteousness by faith, by the work of his Spirit in their heart. That's what God was trying to set up there in verse 5. But now we have to keep on moving. We have to keep on moving to verse 6. We saw that God is trying to establish righteousness by faith in this message in verse 5 that God was bringing to them. It was inviting them to receive the righteousness of Christ, which is made manifest in obedience to all of the commandments of God. Testimonies to Ministers, page 91 in paragraph 1. Paragraph 2, rather. It was inviting them to receive his righteousness, which is made manifest in obedience to all of his commandments. This is the 1880 message that God was bringing to them back there in, I don't know what year it was. Verse 6. In verse 6, God shares with them now his covenant. First, he taught them how to enter into the covenant. First, God is so good. First, he taught them how to enter into this covenant. Now in verse 6, he shares with them his covenant so that they can do what they did before. Watch this in verse 6. He says, and ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and in a holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. God shares with them his covenant with the children of Israel. And he told them that, hey, I'm going to make you a royal priesthood. This is the same thing that he told to Abraham. This is the same covenant that he told to Abraham. Remember in Genesis chapter 17 and verse 6? In Genesis chapter 17, and actually from verse 1 to verse, I believe, about 9, it's a sevenfold promise that we find there to Abraham. And in verse 6, it's that covenant. In verse 6, he says, and I will make thee exceeding fruitful, and I will make nations of thee, and kings shall come out of thee. So you see, God was literally repeating the same covenant that he shared with Abraham to the children of Israel right over here. The same covenant. You see, God doesn't change, you see. And so it's the same covenant here with these children of Israel. But before we notice their reply, before we notice the reply of the children of Israel, let us notice Abraham's reply. Let us notice how did Abraham reply when God shared with him his covenant. God shared with the children of Israel his covenant, the same way he shared his covenant with Abraham. Let's notice how Abraham replied before we notice how Israel replied. In Genesis chapter 15, the 15th chapter of the book of Genesis, in verse 6, very, very popular verse. Very, very popular verse, Genesis chapter 15 and verse 6. And the Bible says, after God shared with Abraham his covenant, and he believed. He did what? He believed in the Lord, and he counted it to him for righteousness. He counted it to him for righteousness. So the children of Abraham, Abraham entered into that new covenant when God shared it with him. He entered into the new covenant by faith. He entered into God's everlasting covenant by faith. Now, how did the children of Israel enter into God's everlasting covenant? How did God, the children of Israel, enter into God's everlasting covenant? Let's go to verse 8. In verse 7, Moses just repeated what God said to the children. And now in verse 8, we're going to see how they reply. Verse 8, the Bible says, and all the people answered together and said, all that the Lord hath spoken, we will do. And Moses returned the word of the people unto the Lord. How did they reply? They said, everything that you said, Lord, we're going to do it. Is that how Abraham replied? No. The Bible says Abraham believed on God, and that was counted unto him for righteousness. Here we find that they say, everything that you say, God, we're going to do it. And that is why Paul called this promise faulty. It is a faulty promise. It is a promise that does not work, you see. It's based upon a faulty promise. It wasn't God's promise, but it was the promise of the people to keep God's promise. And we remember what God's promise is. God's promise is to produce in them the righteousness of his son, the eternal life of his son, and to bring them the eternal inheritance, the eternal new world of his son. That is the promise that God was making to them. He was told them that I'm going to make you a royal priesthood. They know nothing about royalty. They were slaves for how long? Over 400 years. So they don't understand how to build a kingdom. They know nothing of that. As a matter of fact, we find later on in 1 Samuel chapter 8 that they say, okay, we want to be a nation like all the other nations. We want a king to establish this kingdom. You see, they wanted to be like every other denomination. They wanted to be like every other nation. They didn't understand God's ways. And later, and basically in them saying, we want to be like every other nation and have a king, they were saying, Lord, we don't want you as a king. We want a king that we can see. And how do you know that? Because that statement that is born of the old covenant later on led them to say, we will not have this man as our king, pointing to Jesus Christ, the promise, the king, the Lord, the Savior. They said they don't want him. So my brothers and my sister, when the children of Israel said, everything that you said, Lord, that we will do, that promise, that faulty promise that they made, God didn't make that promise, they made it. They said everything you said, God, we're going to do. They made that promise. That faulty promise excluded the work of Christ. That faulty promise that they made excludes Christ because it's their promise. God's promises are in Christ. They're in him. They are yea and amen. Their promise was their promise to fulfill God's promise. It excludes Christ and his work. It excludes Christ and his work, brothers and sisters. What it includes is their work. And this statement bears much repeating, that there is not a point that needs to be repeated more frequently. There is not a point that needs to be dwelt upon more earnestly, repeated more frequently, or established more firmly in the minds of all than the impossibility of fallen man meriting anything by his own best good works. Salvation is through faith in Jesus Christ alone. The faulty covenant established by the people, initiated by the people, as the Bible says, for finding fault with them. In Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 8, the fault was found with the people. The fault was in their promise to do something that they were perfectly incapable of doing. We don't have it in us to fulfill God's promise of righteousness. Let's bring it home for a second. You ever wake up in the morning and you say, I'm going to be a good person today. I'm not going to disrespect anybody. I'm going to be really kind to people that are really mean to me. And I'm going to do good. I want to please God. I'm going to get it done. Our promises are as ropes of sand. The Bible discourages us to make promises to God. So does the spirit of prophecy. It discourages us. Because when we make that promise and then we break it, what happens? We become depressed. We lose confidence in ourselves because of our forfeited pledges. Steps of Christ, page 47. I recommend you read that, paragraph 1. We lose confidence in God because we think that in us making our promise, God just has to back up our promise. And then when that fails, we think God fails and we start to lose faith. Our faith is not to be in ourselves and in our abilities or anything of that nature. Our faith is to be in Jesus Christ and his blood and that alone. Because it is only in looking at Jesus, as it's in Desire of Ages, page 302, it is the soul that keeps his eyes fixed on Christ. The Holy Spirit ceases not until he produces in him the image of God. Our faith needs to be based on nothing less than Jesus Christ and his righteousness. And his work, not ours. The promises of man never work. They never have worked. When is the last time that your promise to God has worked? And let's say it did work. You think that that merits a reward? You think that because you kept the Sabbath or because you paid your tithe that God owes you something? God is not a debtor. God owes no man anything. The only reason why you will receive eternal life and righteousness is because of your faith and dependence and belief in the Son of God and in His work and in continuously looking at Him on the cross of Calvary and on looking at Him as He moved into the holy place and pouring out His Holy Spirit and on looking at Him as He's right now in the most holy place doing a work of atonement, of cleansing our hearts of sin, so that we can be kind to our neighbor, so that we wouldn't retaliate to those that do evil towards us. Those are the really difficult parts of life, right? When someone does evil to us, and we just want to retaliate, we just want to respond. But God's promise that is in Christ, which involved you, which had upon Christ your fallen, weak, sinful nature, we find that when Christ was reviled, He did what? He kept faith in God and He reviled not. Brother, God's promise, sister, God's promise is that when you are in a position of weakness, of abuse, of cruelty, that His character will be thoroughly revealed in you. That is the new covenant experience that you may have. But many of us are in the old covenant where we say, I'm going to flex my muscles and I'm not going to retaliate. I'm not going to say anything bad. I'm not going to sin in word, deed, or thought. I'm going to do it. Brothers and sisters, the songwriter said, not I, but Christ. The Bible says, I am crucified. We need to deny ourselves. That's what it is. We're not denying ourselves. We're not denying ourselves. And because we're not denying ourselves, we're thinking that with ourselves, we're going to keep God's covenant. It doesn't work that way. You see, the children of Israel tried to enter the experience of God's everlasting covenant by making their own promise to produce God's works. And the Bible calls that the old faulty covenant. That is the old covenant. It is the promise of the people to keep God's promise. God didn't ask Abraham to make a promise back. But Abraham believed, and that was counted unto him for righteousness, which was God's promise to him and to you and to me all along. The old covenant was not initiated by God. It was initiated by the people. But then we saw that God says, He called it the covenant that I made with the fathers. Why does He do that? We want to understand that now. Why does God call it the covenant that He made with the fathers? Why is God taking responsibility for their fault? Why is God taking responsibility for their fault? Because God is love. You see, God was working with them from their point of failure. He was slowly teaching them, you see. He was taking responsibility for their failures and for their fault and working with them from their point of fault and failure. He was basically, he took a step back with them to take this detour of the old covenant with them to bring them into the new covenant experience, which, by the way, is not according to the dispensation of time, but it's the condition of their heart. He was trying to change their heart. So what did He do? And we're going to study that, by the way, the idea of the dispensationalist in regards to the covenants. Some believe that God had one way of saving people before the cross, and then He had a way of saving them after the cross. And we're going to see in our next study, and maybe a little bit in this study too, that there's only one way of salvation, which is Jesus Christ. What did God do to take this detour with them after they made that faulty promise? What did God do to take a detour with them to bring them back, to lead them to the place where they realize, look, my faith needs not be in my promise, but in the promise of God, which is Jesus Christ? God gave them in chapter 20 the 10 commandments. God gave them the Ten Commandments so that they can see how high his character is. Because God's law is a transcript of his character. So God goes on to give them his Ten Commandments so that they can see how high his law is and how impossible it is for them to in any way get any of it done. When you look at the law of God, you look at this thing and say, I can't do this. I cannot do this. That's why he gave them the Ten Commandments. You see, if they didn't make that promise, then God wouldn't have given them the Ten Commandments. He would have written it in their hearts. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 16, and Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 10. He would have written it in his heart. Ezekiel chapter 36 and verse 26 and 27 as well. Jeremiah chapter 31 and verse 31 as well. As a matter of fact, God quoted, in Hebrews chapter 8, it quotes Jeremiah 31 and verse 31, where God makes the promise with Judah and whatnot. But God gave them the Ten Commandments so they can realize that it is impossible for them to fulfill that promise. Only God can do it in them. But then what do we find them do? Again, in chapter 24 and verse 17, the Bible and verse 7, the Bible says that he, Moses, took the book of the covenant and read it in the audience of the people. And they said, all that the Lord hath said will we do and be obedient. Noble, but impossible. They did not, like us, have the wherewithal to obey. It was not in them. It was outside of them. And the only way to make it happen in them is to receive it by faith. In the book, Our Father Cares, page 205, the most wonderful statement is found therein. It says, the Ten Commandments, thou shalt and thou shalt not, are 10 promises assured to us if we render obedience to the law governing the universe. They're 10 promises, not 10 commandments. You see, love can't be commanded because the Bible says that love is the fulfilling of the law. So love cannot be commanded. You can't command love. It's something that freely comes out of the heart, you see. So God needed to put the Holy Spirit in their heart so that this thing can freely flow, so that his righteousness can freely flow out of their heart. That's why God gave them the law, so that they can realize, I can't do this. I need something to work in me, both to will and to do according to his righteousness. I can't do it myself. But they reacted and said, all that the Lord has said, that we will do. God wants us to have an intelligent, loving relationship with him. Not a slave master and slave relationship where it's like God says one thing, and we're like, okay, yes, God. No, he wants us to have an intelligent relationship with him, a relationship based on faith, you see, a relationship based on faith. And so he gives us the Ten Commandments, which are 10 promises that we experience by faith. It's his promise, you see. It's his, as a matter of fact, the Bible says in Psalm 119 and verse 66, how we are to react to the Ten Commandments, how we are to react to the 10 promises, the law of God. The Bible says, teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I have believed thy commandments. So the commandments are something that we believe. They're promises that we believe, brothers and sisters and friends. There's something that we believe. But God calls this covenant, he calls it his covenant. Now we want to go to Deuteronomy chapter 5. We want to understand, why does God call this faulty covenant? Why does he call the faulty covenant, that promise that they made, why does he call that his covenant? We saw that he took responsibility for it. Even as Christ took responsibility for your and my fault, your and my guilt, as though he did it. He felt the guilt and the shame. Isaiah chapter 53, it talks all about it, how he felt our sorrows as though it were his. He felt our sins as though it were his. He felt the full wrath of God as though he were the impenitent sinner. He felt it, you see. And that same principle God applies with the covenants. He takes responsibility for it. He didn't initiate it. He did not initiate it. It is not God's way of salvation. our promise of the old covenant, which is the old covenant, is not God's way of salvation. It never has been. God's way of salvation has always been faith in Jesus Christ. That's why he told them again in Exodus chapter 19, keep my covenant. So you already had a covenant that was always there. But then after that, they said, we will keep this covenant. And the Bible calls that the first covenant. So right after we notice Deuteronomy 5, we want to notice, if God always had this covenant, why is the promise of the people, why is that faulty promise, why is that called the old or the first covenant if God already had a covenant before that? We're going to notice that in a minute, so keep that in the back of your mind. We're going to come to that in a second, but I want you to notice Deuteronomy chapter 5 because there's something very important there that helps us understand the idea that may remain in our minds that, no, the old covenant is God's covenant. It is not, brothers and sisters. It is not. Notice, we're going to read verse 2, 3, 29, and 28 and 29. And the Bible says, the Lord our God made a covenant with us in Horeb. The Lord our God made a covenant with us in Horeb. The Lord made not his covenant with our fathers, but with us, even us, who are all of us here alive this day. And the Lord heard the voice of your words when ye spake unto me. And the Lord said unto me, I have heard the voice of the words of the people. Pay close attention. Which they have spoken. So this is the promise that they made, God is talking about. Which they have spoken unto thee. They have said well. They have well said all that they have spoken. Oh, that there were such an heart in them that they would fear me and keep all of my commandments always, that it might be well with them and with their children forever. Notice this note. A mistaken view of these texts in Deuteronomy chapter 5 gives rise to the view that God himself initiated the old covenant. The account of Exodus chapter 19, verse 4 to verse 8, shows God repeating the new covenant to Israel. The only sense in which Moses said that the Lord our God made a covenant with us is that God was forced to ratify the covenant that the Israelites had mistakenly initiated. If they would not keep step with God, he must humble himself to keep step with them. Paul was probably the first to clearly understand what happened. The law had become our schoolmaster or our pedagogue, bringing us on a long detour of centuries until finally we should see the outworking of the old covenant that we might be justified by faith. Galatians 3, verse 22 to 24. God's statement that Israel has well spoken all that they have spoken in Deuteronomy, that statement can only be understood in the context of the next verse. Their heart was not in their words, and they could not be so long as they did not believe God's new covenant promise. In other words, when God said, everything that they said, they have spoken correctly, they have spoken well, God was basically saying, that was a great speech. That was really noble of them to say everything that you say, Lord, we're going to do. That was really, really noble of them. I just wish that they had the heart to obey. That's what he says in verse 29. The same applies in all other spaces where the Lord seems to refer to the covenant at Sinai as his own, just as in Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 9. This covenant was based upon their promise, their faulty promise. And though God was saying the promise that I made with their fathers, and later on he said that it was his, God took responsibility for it and worked with them from where they are, yes, but it was not his. He did not initiate it. God does not call us to make promises to him. He calls us to have faith in his promise, which are all in Christ, and in him are yea and amen. But in Deuteronomy, we see God repeating that it's my promise and whatnot. But then he goes on to say, hey, everything that they said, it's a good thing that they said. But I just wish that they had the heart. But they didn't. And so in fact, what they said, while it was good, it was valueless. Their promise was of no value. It was faultless. Fault-filled, rather. It was faulty. So now, why is the faulty covenant called the old or first covenant? That's very easy to answer. Go to Hebrews chapter 9. Go to Hebrews chapter 9. We're going to read the word of God to allow it to answer that. Why was that faulty covenant called the first if God has always had his covenant? And we're going to see this in Hebrews chapter 9. We're going to see this in Hebrews chapter 9. I'll tell you exactly why right now. The reason why the Sinaitic covenant, that faulty or first, that old covenant, the reason why it's called the first or the old covenant, because it was the first, not because it was the first given. It's not because it was the first given, but it was because it was the first that was ratified by sacrificial blood. That is why it's called the first covenant or the old covenant. It's because their promise was the first that was ratified by sacrificial blood. The second covenant, the second testament, the new testament, the new covenant, God's everlasting covenant, was ratified by the blood of Jesus later on in 31 AD. So the Bible says that in Hebrews chapter 9, for those that are interested. In chapter 9, you want to note this down because this is from the Bible, verse 13 to verse 15 and verse 18 to verse 21. And there the Bible says in verse 13 to verse 15, the Bible says, "For if the blood of bulls and goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifieth to the purifying of the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ," amen, "who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. And for this cause, he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death for the redemption of transgression, that were under the first testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance." Verse 18. "Whereupon neither the first testament was dedicated without blood. For when Moses had spoken every precept to all the people according to the law, he took the blood of the calves and of the goats, which with water and scarlet wool and hyssop, and sprinkled both the book and all the people, saying, 'This is the blood of the testament which God hath enjoined unto you.' Moreover, he sprinkled with blood both the tabernacle, all the vessels of the ministry." Now that's taken from Exodus, the book of Exodus, chapter 24, verse 4 to verse 8, where it explains how Moses sprinkled that blood over the books and over the tabernacle and the vessels of the ministry. So the first covenant that was established by them, by the people, the old covenant, the reason why it's called the first is because it's the first one that was ratified by sacrificial blood. The second covenant, the second testament, the New Testament, the everlasting covenant, God's covenant, is who? Christ. That's why Christ said, "This is my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting testament." The second testament, ratified by his sacrificial blood. So brothers and sisters, as we wind down, we see that the old covenant is basically the old man trying to fulfill God's promise. Is the old man trying to perform the righteousness of God. But the new covenant is the righteousness of God being performed in the new man by the Spirit of God. In the book of Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 22, the Bible says, that ye put off concerning the former conversations the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts. You see, the old man is not able to fulfill the new covenant. So it's the new old man who tries to fulfill the everlasting covenant that produces the old covenant. But the new man, the new man is produced by the new covenant. So you see, the old covenant is very egocentric. It's the old man trying to do. But the new man, the new covenant, is Christ-centered, because the new covenant is Christ. Christ is the covenant, and the new covenant is Christ making the new man. You see that? It is Christ making the new man, the new brand of a creature, which is in Christ Jesus, where old things are passed away and all things are made new. And we know in Romans chapter 7, and I want you to take time on your own to read Romans chapter 7, especially verse 19 to verse 20, verse 23, where it explains how there's a war in the member. There's a war in the member, and the old man always falls. Oh, he wants to do good, but he just cannot get it done, because it is not in him. He doesn't have the wherewithal, the capacity, the ability to get it done. And those who stay in the old covenant and stick to allowing the old man to continue to try to be better by his own might and his own strength, what we find that the old man does, because it could happen to any one of us, we are all sinners saved by the same grace. None of us is better. We can all fall into the old man experience, which is the old covenant experience, trying to do the righteousness of God by our own strength. But we find that, as it says in Romans chapter 10, verse 1, 2, and 3, it explains that what happens is that we will try to establish the righteousness of God, and we're going to call that our own righteousness. As a matter of fact, let me just turn there and just read that real quickly for you. Romans chapter 10, because that's a very, 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 very important text. And the Bible says, I'll read from verse 2. The old man, he has a zeal for God. It says, "For I bear them record that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God." Verse 4. "For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth." Christ is the end result of the law in your heart. Meaning, when you have the law of God in your heart, written by the Holy Spirit, then the result in you is Christ. Everything about Christ is in you. The hope of glory, the mystery of godliness, the experience of the new covenant. So we see Jesus in the new covenant, but we don't see him in the old. We see ourselves in the old trying to fulfill God's promise, but in the new covenant, we see Jesus. As it says in Romans chapter 6 and verse 6, "Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin." This is the experience that you may have in the new covenant, which is Christ, our covenant. As I close, I want to read this statement from the book Glad Tidings, written by the servant of the Lord, who brought a most precious message to God's people. His name is E.J. Wagner. And there he says, the difference, this is page 100 to 101. He says, the difference between the two covenants may be put briefly thus. In the covenant from Sinai, we ourselves have to do with the law alone. While in the covenant from above, we have the law in Christ. In the first instance, it is death to us, since the law is sharper than any two-edged sword, and we are not able to handle it without fatal results. But in the second instance, we have the law in the hand of a mediator. In the one case, it is what we can do. In the other case, it is what the Spirit of God can do. Bear in mind that there is not the slightest question in the whole epistle of Galatians as to whether or not the law should be kept. The only question is, how shall it be done? It is to be our own doing, so that it is to be our own doing, so that the reward shall not be of grace, but of debt? Or is it to be God working in us, both to will and to do according to his good pleasure? My brother and my sister, we're, I pray, in a place in our life where we realize that we need to surrender all to God. We need to surrender all of our promises because they're all as ropes of sand. They don't work. We need to surrender all of those contracts and compacts that we made with God. Lord, I'm going to do this for you if you do this for me. Lord, I'm going to give this to you if you give this to me. God is not motivated to give you anything for anything that you do. God is motivated by one thing, and that one thing is love. And he wants that love to so work in your heart as well. That's why the Bible says in Galatians 5 and verse 6 that faith works by love. That's the only way that our faith will function. That's why God continuously displays his love to us, so that we can realize, I don't have to make a promise to God so that he can do something for me, but because he loves me so, he gave up his son for me. If God gave up his son, what else would he keep from us? As it says in the book of Romans chapter 8, if he gave up his son, he's willing to give us more and more and more of his spirit and of this deliverance from, whether it be financially or whether we have family problems, church problems, work problems, whatever our issue may be, we don't need to make a promise to God for him to fulfill it for us. We need to look at his love as is displayed on the cross of Calvary and allow faith to be built. That's why he says here, pay attention, keep my promise, and I'm going to fulfill it in your heart, in your life, and I'm going to clear things out of your way, but you got to look at me. You have to surrender yourself, your promises, your ways. Give up all of those things, or else you're going to go through a long detour like the children of Israel. I promise to let you know what exactly is the old covenant, the end time form of the old covenant. My brother and my sister, the end time form of the old covenant, that experience of slavery and sin and trying to get out by making promises to God, but being, as Paul says, I'm wretched in Romans chapter 7. At this point, you just got a hint because I used that word wretched. It came up twice in the Bible, in Romans chapter 7 and in Revelation chapter 3. The end time form of the old covenant is Laodicean lukewarmness, which is the experience of God's last church. As the Spirit of Prophecy says, that we are all about the law, the law, the law, until we become as dry as the hills of Gilboa. My brothers and my sisters, we need to do better. The question is not whether or not the law needs to be kept. It must be kept. You break the law, that's it. And we've done that many a time, but we have Jesus, who not only forgives us of all our sins, but cleanses us and works in us to keep his law by his faith, by his work, by his righteousness. So the Laodicean condition is the old covenant condition that we can only escape through that third angel's message of righteousness by faith, as we've been studying it in the new covenant. So it is my prayer that as we continue to study the old and the new covenant, that we keep in mind, I need to have a new covenant experience. I need to let go of my promises, of my strength, and hold on to the strength of God, because in my weakness, his strength is made perfect. And as I hold on to his promises, his covenant is going to be fulfilled in me. His covenant being his promise, which is found in Christ, because in him are all God's promises are yea and amen. I need to hold on to Christ, so that I won't be someone living in the end time experiencing the old covenant, but I will be one experiencing the new covenant of Jesus Christ. I want to surrender all to Jesus. Let's close with a word of prayer. Father in heaven, again, we thank you so much for the truth as it is in your Son, Jesus. We want to give up ourselves and we want to surrender all completely to you. We have nothing more to say, Lord. We want to give up our promises, which are as ropes of sand. We want to give them up and hinge ourselves to Jesus Christ, our righteousness, and his promise of righteousness, eternal life, and the eternal inheritance. We ask that you may put it in us to continue to surrender. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.